Le pido al equipo de producción que por favor nos coloque ahí en pantalla a nuestro queridísimo amigo. Él, como ustedes saben, es un amigo que ya ha estado con nosotros. Su nombre es Vidak Radojic, es el CEO del grupo Beryl. No solamente eso, es uno de estos consultores que ayudan a los manejadores de fondos en la parte de lo que serían los fondos de cobertura. E indudablemente lo hemos traído hoy para que nos ayude a entender qué es lo que está pasando con la inteligencia artificial y cómo, fíjense bien lo interesante, muchas cosas de la inteligencia artificial estarían afectando el proceso de las inversiones de los inversionistas institucionales y que empieza a afectarnos a todos nosotros que tenemos nuestros portafolios de inversión. Le doy las gracias, Vidak. Thank you for coming to el cierre de Wall Street. I'm very happy to have you back. And I think that the first question entering into the actual artificial intelligence environment, we would like to discuss with you what are probably those real applications that you are seeing might have a benefit when the people are using what is called the LLM, large language model, into the investment management. What are the ramifications of all those models when you are managing a portfolio? Thank you for coming, Vidak.
Hi, Victor. Thank you for having me on your show. And thank you for the question. Topics like LLM, generative AI, and agentic AI have been front and center at our annual Beryl Leads conference, actually. So current application, as you mentioned, of LLM and AI in investment management specifically. Number one, it's research and market intelligence. So natural language processing, which stands for NLP, helps digest vast volumes of unstructured data, news, earning calls, filing, social media. LLMs like GPT are used to summarize analyst reports, flag sentiment changes, or generate macroeconomic briefs. Number two, we have a portfolio management. AI-driven models help with factor modeling, that's volatility, momentum, liquidity, regime detection, i.e. bull slash bear market transitions, and portfolio optimization. Then we have risk management as well that is applied very effectively. So AI helps identify hidden correlations and stress test scenarios. It can read and summarize regulatory documents, which enhances compliance risk assessments. That's very important. Another thing is client reporting and communication. LLMs are used to automate commentary on portfolio performance and markets, and then deal sourcing finally on private equity and VCs. AI scans the market for emerging startups, trends, or mergers and acquisition targets based on proprietary or third-party data. It helps rank opportunities based on, let's say, growth, intellectual property, teams, etc.
Let me ask you something, because obviously out of the equation, when you name all these opportunities and tools, the real question here and now to try to make the audience a little bit more aware of what's happening, and I'm going to steal you a moment before I ask you the question in English. I'm going to tell them in español. Lo que estamos hablando con él es algo muy importante e interesante porque efectivamente nos está diciendo cuáles son todas esas herramientas que obviamente se están usando el día de hoy para tratar de atrapar más los mercados. En los mercados lo que se trata en definitiva, desde el punto de vista matemático, es de buscar dónde está lo que se denomina alfa, capturarlo, que es básicamente lo que me hace crecer el rendimiento de mi portafolio. Pero lo que le voy a preguntar a él es, si con todas estas herramientas nosotros estamos observando que los managers están teniendo mejores retornos, porque la volatilidad y los cambios siempre han estado en la existencia del mercado, y si se refleja, porque a veces nos llenamos de muchas cosas y no entregamos lo que el cliente final quiere, que es un rendimiento. Listen, Vidak, the thing is that I'm telling the audience is that when you mention all those tools about reading and regulatory things, about risk management and finding opportunities, isn't your perception that the manager have now an edge and an ability to perform better? Or you still seeing that no matter what you came with, the capital market are very difficult to actually read and still have some managers that are not delivering that alpha that they praise they are looking
absolutely,
for?
Absolutely, Victor, entiendo todo. So real world examples before I proceed is BlackRock, one of the biggest public publicly traded companies for public markets. They use Aladdin. It's an AI-powered risk and analytical platform across its investment teams. It integrates NLP, which I mentioned before, to process news, regulatory documents and earnings calls. So obviously, it's amazing. They also use custom LLMs, large language models, to help analysts generate macroeconomic summaries and performance commentary. So another real world example is Two Sigma. We just spoke to them this morning. It's a quant hedge fund, $70 billion in AUM, where machine learning models drive much of the alpha generation. Alpha for your audience is excess return, have to actually beat the market, irrespectively the market goes up and down. The Two Sigmas, they have invested heavily in alternative data as well, satellite imagery, credit card receipts to forecast economic events. And they had proprietary LLM already in 2009, back then. Bridgewater Associates, they focus also on building an AI system that can read and interpret macroeconomic data, similar to how Ray Dalio, a famous investor, team is interpreting it. And then Citadel is kind of doing almost the same thing. So in terms of benefits, efficiency, these tools automate time-consuming tasks like document review or initial due diligence, which is what we do, due diligence. Scale, they can monitor thousands of signals, data points simultaneously. Customization, they enable personalized portfolio strategies or risk alert. And they have an edge in unstructured data, so they can parse, analyze alternative data, like satellite data, ESG disclosures, social media, etc. And speed, obviously. The limitations is data quality issue. AI is only as good as the data. If data is not good, then you cannot get good answers. Limited common sense. LLM can so-called hallucinate or misinterpret nuances in complex documents, and lack of interpretability. Many models, especially deep learning, are black boxes.
So let me ask you something. Hold on. So do you think that with these tools, they has been delivering, again, better returns, the BlackRock, the Citadel, the Bridgewater of the world? Or do you think that it's a non-event? Because obviously everybody's using those tools, but at the end of the day, markets are wild, salvajes, nadie controla el mercado, and then is the same old. What is that in your opinion?
Great question. Global macro managers as a whole, they have underperformed. They had the worst year-to-date performance on the record. They don't use much of these techniques and tools that I just mentioned. Two Sigma, on the other hand, they're up 15%. So I think in this environment where everything is driven by what the administration is saying in some ways, having these tools is very, very useful. However, it's very expensive to deploy them. So not everybody can have that.
So give me one second. Let me explain that because I think it's very important. Lo que estamos hablando con ella, lo que quería traer, es que en algunos casos creemos, oiga bien esto, de que cuando tenemos toda esta cantidad de herramientas, nos estamos llenando de una cantidad de cosas que no surten efecto. Y la realidad, y es por eso que hay muchos analistas que hablan de que la inteligencia artificial empieza a cambiar todo, es que las firmas que están usando, como él hablaba, Two Sigma, es como se llama, Two Sigma, es el nombre del fondo, ellos han hecho una cantidad de oportunidades de retorno muy importantes porque usan estas herramientas de las cuales él nos está hablando. Mientras que otros, manejadores de dinero que están en el área global macro, les ha ido muy mal, pero ellos no usan estas herramientas aún, lo que da a entrever que esto que estamos discutiendo con él efectivamente tiene una particularidad muy importante a la hora de tomar decisiones. Vidak, I think that you mentioned and you were talking about, I think this is what you were talking about, everything about the AI agents and all that is transforming. Exactly. But now, if we have to move forward with the other part, what people is being concerned, I'm going to ask you specifically about Google, is where they should be looking at this point where you are seeing that Google, and obviously you and I has been using Google all the time, has been disrupted by all these LLM models, which is large language model, which is basically artificial intelligence. What do you think it will be the impact of Google losing market share in all this fiasco that basically is bringing new actors into the investment management world?
Yeah, this is an excellent question, and it's a trillion-dollar question. Since the launch of ChatGPT, particularly GPT-4 and now GPT-4.5, traditional search models like Google are facing real pressure for the first time in decades. So people want answers, not ads, and search behavior is evolving fast. So AI tools like ChatGPT are at the center of that shift or disruption, if you wanna be a little bit more upfront. User increasingly turn to LLMs for direct conversational answers rather than sifting through links, which is the old method. This shift is especially noticeable in areas like coding, help, research summaries, quick explanations, where LLMs outperform traditional search in speed and user experience. Now, this isn't just a change in tools, it's a change of mindset. People are using AI more strategically to enhance how they work, learn, and make decisions. It's a clear signal the fourth industrial revolution is well underway. So what's happening with Google's market share? Another question you had. Google market share dipped below 90% for the first time in a decade. That's a major milestone. Users are actively looking at LLMs. AI is becoming the new default. ChatGPT is used as a primary research tool. It jumped from 1% to 8% in just 6 months. So why? Because people want the right answers. They're not looking for ads. The content is...
Let me ask you something. So do you think that now a more, let's say, a regular question for the audience. So do you think that this increase of people using ChatGPT is just going to keep going higher and higher, and you see that the other things that we have in Google are basically lowering the ability for people to relay in those type of things? Do you think that the future will be some sort of tools that do not represent advertising, but actually the bottom line that most of these clients need? So do you think that people paying more for artificial intelligence tools like that? Or you think that it will be a free launch down the road because everybody might have some LLM, tools to provide to the audience? What do you think is going to happen?
I think this is clearly a disruption, user experience. I mean, Google is an amazing company. They're going to come up with something up front. They're not, let's not say that Google is losing market share. They're losing tiny market share. They're still a gorilla in this game. However, user experience is really what counts, and that's how I think it's going to be driven in the future.
Listen, Vidak, thank you very much for explaining that to the audience. Le vamos a estar hablando en un rato de todo otra vez lo que nos ha explicado él con respecto a la inteligencia artificial. Vidak, thank you very much. We're going to bring you back to the el cierre de Wall Street in a few weeks. Thank you, and we'll get back to you soon.
You're welcome.
Thank you very much.
Gracias. Thank you.